Postscript for Psalm 103. We are personal witnesses to a great psalm of praise. We praise God with our talk as well as our new walk. Psalm 103 is a psalm of thanksgiving and of praise to our divine benefactor, Jesus Christ. All who have been born anew have a personal testimony and are apt witnesses to the transformation made possible by the propitiation of the risen Christ. We read of witnesses through Dr. Luke's testimony in Acts 1:3, to these he also presented himself alive after his suffering, by many convincing proofs, appearing to them over a period of 40 days and speaking of the things concerning the kingdom of God. In Acts 2:32, Peter is speaking to men of Jerusalem on Pentecost when he attests to the resurrection. God has resurrected this Jesus. We are all witnesses of this. In Acts 3:14-15, where Peter is speaking to the men who just witnessed the miraculous healing of the lame man at Solomon's colonnade, where he boldly, at the risk of his life, leveled this accusation, "But you denied the Holy and Righteous One and asked to have a murderer given to you. You killed the source of life, whom God raised from the dead. We are witnesses of this." Acts 4:8-11. Then Peter was filled with the Holy Spirit and said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, 9. If we are being examined today about a good deed done to a disabled man, by what means he was healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, whom you crucified and whom God raised from the dead, by him, this man is standing here before you healthy. This Jesus is the stone rejected by you builders, which has become the cornerstone." Inadvertently, the temple priest became secondary witnesses to the resurrection of Christ in Acts 4:13-16, when they observed the boldness of Peter and John and realized that they were uneducated and untrained men. They were amazed and recognized that they had been with Jesus. And since they saw the man who had been healed standing with them, they had nothing to say in response. After they had ordered them to leave the Sanhedrin, they conferred among themselves, saying, "What should we do with these men? For an obvious sign, evident to all who live in Jerusalem, has been done through them, and we cannot deny it. But are there first-hand eyewitness testimonies of the resurrected Christ?" Historicity requires validating first-hand eyewitnesses. Our Bible recites this transformation narrative of Peter the Apostle, who fearfully denied knowing Christ before the crucifixion, but then after Jesus' resurrection, we can read about the transformation that took place in the transformed attitudes of the apostles, beginning in Acts 5:17-21, then the high priest took action. He and all his colleagues, those who belonged to the party of the Sadducees, were filled with jealousy. So, they arrested the apostles and put them in the city jail. But an angel of the Lord opened the doors of the jail during the night, brought them out, and said, "Go and stand in the temple complex, and tell the people all about this life." In obedience to this, they entered the temple complex at daybreak and began to teach. When the high priest and those who were with him arrived, they convened the Sanhedrin, the full senate of the sons of Israel, and sent orders to the jail to have them brought. When the temple priest arrived at the jail, they found the guards outside of the door, which was locked, but no one was in the jail. So, they returned to report to the priests. We read in Acts 5:25 that then someone came and reported to them, "Look, the men you put in jail are standing in the temple complex and teaching the people." Without a fuss, the men were brought in to speak again to the priests. In verses 28 and 29 we read that the priests said to the apostles in verse 28, "Didn't we strictly order you not to teach in this name? And look, you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching and are determined to bring this man's blood on us." But Peter and the apostles replied in Acts 5:30-32, "The God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom you had murdered by hanging him on a tree. God exalted this man to his right hand as ruler and savior, to grant repentance to Israel, and forgiveness of sins. We are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit whom God has given to those who obey him." Keep in mind that these priests had the power to make life very uncomfortable for these witnesses of Christ, and possibly take their lives from them. In Acts 10:39-42, we find Peter speaking at Cornelius's house, we ourselves are witnesses of everything he did in both the Judean country and in Jerusalem, yet they killed him by hanging him on a tree. God raised up this man on the third day and permitted him to be seen, not by all the people, but by us, witnesses appointed beforehand by God, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to solemnly testify that he is the one appointed by God to be the judge of the living and the dead. The Apostle Paul affirms the resurrection of Jesus in 1 Corinthians 15:1-6, "Now brothers, I want to clarify for you the gospel I proclaimed to you, you received it and have taken your stand on it. You are also saved by it if you hold to the message I proclaimed to you unless you believed for no purpose. For I passed on to you as most important what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to over 500 brothers at one time, most of them are still alive, but some have fallen asleep." So, Paul testifies that the risen Christ was witnessed by over 500 men. Then the apostle confirms the depth of his faith in Jesus's resurrection in verse 17. "And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless, you are still in your sins." Can you personally praise God for the transforming nature deposited in you by God's Holy Spirit?